Welcome to Applied Mathematical Finance. And we started a section on convexity adjustments. So we are in this sections on convexity adjustments. And yeah, let me very shortly recapitulate a few things. So we introduced some general setup. So the setup we are looking at is that we have some index. So here is some index, which is modeled under here Qn, where n is a numerator. And if this index is then, or a function of this index is paid in units of this numerator. So I pay here a function of the index in units of this numerator, maybe at some later time. Okay, there's some t star here. Then there is some analytic valuation formula. So maybe this is the natural payment unit. So I have an analytic valuation formula, and I denote this formula with V subscript n here. And the question is, how does the valuation look like if I now consider, say, the same function of the index paid in a different unit m? So the question is, how does the value V subscript m at time zero look like if I pay here the same function of this index fixed at capital T in a different unit? So now I pay here in units of m. So we derived then that if we know the instantaneous covariance, so if we know here this part, the instantaneous covariance of the value process under the natural payment unit n, and the change of unit, so the change of numerator, you would say, if we know this covariance, let's say here the integrated instantaneous covariance and then the expectation of that, then this defines the convexity adjustment. So this defines then a term that describes the difference of the valuation in unit n, so when I pay in units of n, and the valuation if I pay in units of m. Of course, there is also here this little factor here. So in case I change some amount by a factor of two by changing these units of curve, of course, then I have to also look at this change. So this gave here rise to this convexity adjustment. So we had some example, the Quanto adjustment paying in an unnatural currency, or the in arrears adjustment paying at an unnatural time, where we then could write down formulas for a forward or a caplet, where the payment was in this unnatural unit that involved here this this term. And what's a bit sad about this formulation? It's maybe too general to be directly applicable, because I need here this instantaneous covariance, where here on the top there is the value process. So this V subscript n, for example, for a caplet paid in natural unit, would be the Plaque or the Plaque-Scholes formula. So this here is the valuation formula at time little t. So I would have to differentiate somehow, or to calculate the differential of the Plaque-Scholes formula. So that's maybe not very applicable in this form. Let's look at some special cases. The first one is where I have some nice representation for this covariance term. And the second one is where I only look at European payoff. So the function only depends on x at a fixed time. Actually, what we have derived in the previous section was only for this case. And the surprising result is that then you can rewrite this adjustment here in a form that is actually independent of the function f. That's a nice little result. Okay, so let's start here. First thing is I will look at a special version where the stochastic processes have a special structure. So first let's introduce here this lemma. So if x and y are two martingales, so in the application later, x is this value vn divided by n, it's a martingale under qn, and y is the m, the new numerator divided by n, it's also a martingale under qn. So if x and y are two martingales where the instantaneous covariance, so dx dy, has this form, xy sigma x sigma y rho xy dt, then if I multiply the product xy with exponential integral sigma x sigma y rho xy dt, so the instantaneous covariance of the logarithm of the two processes, if I then multiply x and y with this term, then the resulting process here, the set, is also a martingale. Also note that at capital T, Z is just X times Y. Why? Because you then just plug in here the capital T. Okay, so let's just check this. So to check if it is a martingale, I just differentiate Z. So if I differentiate Z, then I have the differential of X times Y, so D of X times Y. And I differentiate here the exponential, but I differentiate with respect to the lower bound. So I get a minus exponential integral times the inner derivative. This lemma holds if x and y are both log normal processes where the correlation structure of the Brownian drivers is rho dt. Yeah? So dw1, dw2 is rho dt. And I have that dx is sigma xx dw1 and dy is sigma y dw2. So like we had for the Quanto Caplet, where we assumed this structure and then concluded that we have this form here. Okay, so to prove, just check. So dz is differentiated x times y times this exponential. This is differentiate first the product x times y multiplied with the exponential, and then multiply x times y with the differential of the exponential. But if you differentiate here the exponential, then you get a minus in front because I am differentiating with respect to the lower bound and the inner derivative. Okay, so and that part here just stays there. So I have these two parts. Yeah. So, but now note, if you differentiate x times y, you have y dx plus x dy plus dx dy. Okay. You know that these two guys here are already martingales. Okay, so I only have to look at this part here. Okay, and now I see that this part is actually canceling by my assumption. Okay, so dx dy is just x times y times this sigma x, sigma y, rho x, y, dt. So this part is just canceling by my assumption with this part. Okay, because we have here this minus. Okay, so you see I'm only left here with the two first order derivatives. And these guys are martingales. Okay, so that's the adjustment I have to apply to make that a martingale. We will use this in our situation. So where this here is the x, and this here is the y. So the x is the value process divided by the natural numerator, and the y is the change of numerator. So we assume that this product, so the instantaneous covariance of the two, is of this form. So if we assume that this is of this form, then I can write my convexity adjustment just by now applying this factor. Yeah, okay. So in this expectation, I can make this here. I can make the process Vn of t divided by n of t, m of little t divided by n of little t. I can make this now a martingale if I multiply with this exponential from little t to capital T with this covariance term here inside. Okay, then you see if you plug in now capital T, then this is just what we have here inside. So I can think of this as being the expectation of the process set of capital T. And now I know that Z of a martingale, so I just get Z of zero, and that's here my Z of zero. Okay, so now you see that assuming that my valuation formula and the change of numerator has this covariance structure gives me that the valuation formula under the unnatural numerator or unnatural payment unit, Vm, is just a multiplicative adjustment to the valuation formula under Vn. Okay, so now we have this result for the log normal process. So for the log normal process, I now have a nice multiplicative adjustment here. So that's just a different version of my convexity adjustment. So now instead of being an additive factor, I now have a multiplicative factor here, and I can explicitly calculate this. So here in the convexity adjustment, there's no longer this expectation operator. So somehow by this special structure, I could get rid of this expectation operator here because I made some assumption that, well, the instantaneous covariance of the logarithm is a deterministic function. Yeah, so this deterministic function here. Well, still a bit unpleasant is that I have to specify the covariance of this valuation formula and the change of numerator. So I still have the problem that I, in theory, would need to have to differentiate here the Black-Scholes formula. Yeah? For example, if V subscript n would be a Black-Scholes formula. Well, there is a surprising thing. if you only consider a European option, so by European option here, I mean that if we just are in the special case where we just pay a single function of the index x at a single point in time, capital T, so actually our assumption in this chapter, then I can give the convexity adjustment independent of the payoff function f. So it does not depend on the payoff function f. And that's a surprising thing, yeah, because that is the guy that enters into in the valuation formula. So here inside somewhere is also the f. Yeah. So what do I pay? Do I pay an European option maximum of s minus k? And I can give the adjustment independent of this. Okay, so how does this work? So I assume that the index that I pay, so logarithm of x, and the change of numerator, so here logarithm of m divided by n. So I assume that the logarithms of these two, they have a deterministic instantaneous covariance. Yeah, so that's just my assumption as before. I assume that d log x d log m divided by n is equal to some deterministic guy dt. Or alternatively, you could write dx dy is xy gamma dt. Okay, so that's the same assumption as before. So I assume we are in this situation. Okay, so here's the assumption. Dx dm divided by n is xm divided by n gamma dt. Okay, and now I assume that there is a valuation formula that, I define that the symbol v of x, so the symbol v of x zero, sigma f and m, this should denote the value of paying f of x fixed at time t in units of m at time capital T. So this is just a formal definition of my valuation formula. Yeah? So I do not assume that I have an analytic expression of this formula. It's just a formal expression. So it just tells me my valuation depends on the initial value of the quantity and then maybe some model parameters. So these two arguments here just determine the model for x. Okay, so the sigma is just a symbolic parameter that there are some other model parameters. And then we have our payoff function. So there is our payoff function f here. So that appears here, and I pay f in of x, yeah, and then I pay this in units of m. So the m is here just an argument in my formula. Then if I have this definition, so I can change the units of in which I pay, then there's the following relation between valuation formulas under the same model. So these here are different valuation formulas, assuming the same model, but different payment units. Okay, so you see there is here the payment unit M on the left-hand side, but on the right-hand side, there's now the payment unit N. Okay, so you can express the valuation formula using the payment unit M in terms of the valuation unit, the valuation formula using the payment unit N, when you do two modifications. Well, the trivial modification is that you just multiply with the ratio of the units in zero. So in case you just pay twice as much, of course, there should be twice as much. And then you modify the initial value of your stochastic process. So you use your valuation formula with a modified initial value, where this modified initial value is x tilde of zero is x of zero times exponential integral from zero to capital T gamma dt. And now note that here the gamma is the same thing as we have before, is the instantaneous covariance between the index and the change of numerator. So he doesn't care about what is the function f. Okay, this is somehow a bit interesting, yeah, because somehow you move the covariance of this part here and that part. So this is what we have looked at earlier. Yeah. So there is the valuation formula, so which is somehow expectation of this part. So somehow it's related to the F and the covariance of that guy. Yeah. So somehow we moved the covariance inside the F. Okay. And of course, the situation is now that I know an analytic formula for a special N. For example, I know Black-Scholes formula here for this special N. And then I can tell you that paying a different unit, paying this option in a different unit, is just use the same valuation formula, but modify the initial value of the index. That's been a nice result. And we have discovered this result for the Quanto. Yeah, so that here was the valuation of the Quanto caplet, if you remember. And actually, we derived here at the fact that we can express the foreign interest rate with a modified initial value. So we got Black-Scholes formula with a modified initial value. So we already saw such a result. Okay, so that's a nice theorem. And maybe a small remark, yeah, I have this theorem here for the special log normal case. You can also derive this under other situations, then maybe the modification to the initial value is different. Yeah, so for a normal case, it's maybe a sum of with an adjustment. Okay, so this theorem shows that under certain assumption, the adjustment, the convexity adjustment, can be translated into a shift of the distribution. And a small remark, yeah, also note that here this condition I had, so the condition which we had before was that the index and the change of numerator m divided by n, this is just x times m divided by n gamma of t dt. So sometimes you see this here with the inverse, okay? So sometimes you have the inverse, and in case where you have the inverse, what's happening is that you just have this relation with a minus. So it means gamma is replaced with a minus gamma. So if you have such a relation with the inverse of the change of numerator, then you get a minus gamma. Actually, that was for the Quanto. Yeah, it was actually the other way around. We will see that. Okay, so let's prove this theorem. So first thing is I just define the modified stochastic process x tilde, which is x times exponential integral from little t to capital T gamma of tau d tau. Okay, so what does this mean? Well, this means if x is a martingale under Qn, then x tilde is a martingale under Qm. Why was that? So because the term, the gamma, is exactly the term that appears in the change of numerator theorem, so Gesernoff theorem. Yeah, it's x times m divided by n gamma dt. Okay, so I have that if now I know the stochastic process here of x, so assume that dx is mu x dt plus sigma x dw, that this holds under Qn, then I know that under Qm, so if I change from n to m, this will become dx is mu plus gamma x dt plus sigma x dw. So that will be under Qm. Okay, so I can maybe write here, though, if I take some expectation of x under Qn, then this is like taking expectation of x times m divided by n under Qm. Okay, and this is like taking expectation of x tilde under Qm. Okay, always of capital T. Okay, so then I have that this gets a change of drift if I move to the different numerator. But now if I plug in the definition of x tilde, yeah, then you see that if you move to x tilde, you get exactly the plus gamma. So this is exactly here the definition of x tilde under this measure Qm. So this means if you look at the difference of x tilde of capital T and x tilde of zero. Now remember, we just look at the European option, so we are only interested in the probability distribution of x tilde of capital T and or x of capital T. So maybe I add this here as a remark. So we are interested in the probability distribution of x of capital T. Yeah, so we pay f of x of capital T. So we take expectation of f of x of capital T. We are interested in the probability distribution of this guy. And if we look at the probability distribution of x of t minus its initial value, then this is the integral of dx. Yeah? And if we look at this under Qn, then this is actually the same as looking at dx tilde under Qn. Yeah? Because on the top, I have that the two stochastic processes look the same under the different measures. So I have that the probability distribution of x of t minus its initial value is the same, so under Qn, is the same as the probability distribution of x tilde of capital T minus x tilde of zero under Qm. So the two have the same distributions under different measures. So x of t under Qm is then the same as x of t minus its initial value plus the initial value of x tilde of 0 under qn. Okay, so the difference has the same probability distribution. So we get this nice result. Okay, so why is that? Yeah, that's because x tilde and x of t agree at the final payment time. Okay, so let's go back here. So you see my adjustment is such that if I plug in capital T, the two random variables agree. So if I pay f of x tilde of capital T and f of x of t, they are actually the same. Yeah, they agree. So x tilde under qm is the same as x of t under qm. And then if I move to qn, it's just the change in the initial value that occurs. So now I can prove the result. So I start with the evaluation formula, having the different unnatural payment unit, capital M of t. I pay the index x of t, given here under the measure qn. So I'm under the measure qn. So moving to the measure qm will replace the numerator n by an m. So I just get here a move to the measure qm. But then I can use my result. Yeah. So the problem is I do not know this here under the measure qm, but I have my result that if I move back to qn, then this corresponds to shifting the distribution, shifting the initial value of the stochastic process. So x of t under qm corresponds to x of t minus x0 plus x tilde of 0 under qm. So that's here the result from above. Okay, so now I'm back under the measure qn. So I just give me an additional multiplied with n of capital T to just see that this is now the valuation formula where I pay in units of n. Okay, with a stochastic process that has a different initial value. So I have here a different initial value for the stochastic process. Okay, so that's a funny result. Let's apply this result for, say, three examples. So two of these we already did, paying the forward rate at a different time, the forward rate in arrears, fixed in arrears or paid in advance. So I would rather think of it as paid in advance, so paying it at a different time. The quanto adjustment, and very nice, also the CMS adjustment. Okay, so let's go quickly through this. The forward rate in arrears. So what was that? That was our motivating example. So I consider here the underlying forward rate for the period TI to TI plus one. And instead of paying it at the natural payment time, which is here the end, I'm paying it at the beginning of the period. So the natural payment time would be here PTI plus one, which I would like to choose as a numerator. Okay. And so that's my N here. The thing is that it's actually paid at PTI. Yeah, so I have here maybe a different unit. Okay, so this here is currently just the definition for any unit. I assume now I'm paying here in any unit. So I know if M is equal to the PTI plus one bond, then I have the natural unit. And I have, for example, a Black-Scholes formula. You would think that maybe it's nice to use now our theorem for M being here PTI. Yeah, so this should be M divided by N, because this is really in the forward rate in arrears, the change of numerator that appears. So I pay in this unit. But I modify the application of our theorem a little bit. So I would like to value now paying my payoff in units of PTI, so at the beginning of the period. But since you see that here this expectation is linear in the payment unit, I can also, as a first step, decompose this into paying in the natural unit plus paying in the difference of the natural unit and the given one. Yeah, so I just decompose this. This is here paying at the beginning of the period, and this is here paying at the end of the period. Okay, so why am I decomposing this? So the reason is that this part here will then result in my change of numerator. So if this here is the M, then my change of numerator will be just M divided by N. And this is the bond at the beginning of the period minus the bond at the end of the period divided by the bond at the end of the period. This is just my Li Ti plus one minus Ti. So the nice thing is that here my change of numerator is directly related to the index. Okay, so I have here appearing the index in the change of numerator. So X is Li. So you can also derive the formula in the other way, then the one plus will occur in this M of zero, but maybe this is a bit nicer. So the model that we assume, we have a model. The model that we assume is a log normal model. So my index is dLi is Li sigma I dWi. So then I can write down that dLi dmn, this is just dLi, dLi, ti plus one minus ti. So this is just Li, Li, sigma squared dt, sigma I, if you like. Also multiplied here with this constant. So I just plug in here my model, Li sigma I here in this dLi dLi, such that I get here this Li Li sigma I squared dt. So I know that my gamma from my previous definition is just here this sigma I squared. So the nice thing is here for this case, the change of numerator covariance term immediately pops out here from my model for my index X. So I do not need an additional model for this, this change of numerator part. So I get that valuation of paying here this part with the different unit is just as if I would modify the initial value by exponential integral sigma squared dt. So I just get this result that I can here modify the initial value, where this modification is just multiply with the exponential of sigma I squared dt. So you have to be a little bit careful here. There is also in our theorem, so now we just applied the theorem. There's also in our theorem here the conversion of m of zero divided by n of zero. But now this part was the bond that pays at the beginning minus the bond that pays at the end of the period divided by the bond that pays at the end of the period. So this is L. Times the period length. So this is Li times the period length. So I dropped the time parameter. So this is just my m divided by n. So you have to note that here this factor is L at zero times the period length. So you get the convexity adjustment for paying at a different time, nicely independent of the European payoff function. Just use the valuation formula with the natural payment unit. So we have here the natural payment unit. Use it twice, once the normal way, and then in addition, the initial value ti plus 1 minus ti with a modified initial value in the valuation formula. Maybe let's go back. Okay, so that was our motivation where we looked at this forward rate in arrears. And you see that here the function f was just the identity, and you see that you have also here these two parts. This here is the payment in natural units, and then you have another part that contains here the period length twice. So you see there is this additional factor with the period length and some term that depends on the variance, sigma squared. Yeah, okay, so that's nice. Yeah, so you can value all kinds of European options under different payment units, paying at a different time. Okay, so you can also define the convexity adjusted rate by using f of x, the identity, which was our motivating example from the introduction. Let's also apply our theorem to the quanto. So what was the situation for the quanto? So in the quanto, I have an option on, say, some foreign interest rate. So I was looking here at some foreign interest rate, well, fixed here at the beginning of the period, okay, minus k and zero. And that is here one paid on one foreign currency unit, but the payment is then converted to domestic currency without actually using the foreign exchange rate. So I have here some unnatural unit I'm paying in. So I pay actually in domestic currency. So my payment unit here is the domestic bond. So I'm paying that at the end of the period. So the time is natural, but the currency is unnatural. The natural numerator for this as a domestic investor, yeah, you remember we are a domestic investor, is the foreign bond converted to domestic currency. Yeah? So it would be here the foreign bond converted to, with the FX rate, to domestic currency. That would be the natural case. So my M is then here the domestic zero coupon bond, and my N is the foreign zero coupon bond in domestic currency. Remember, in this section, we defined the change of numerator. Actually, we defined the inverse, N divided by N, which was the forward FX rate. Yeah? A foreign bond in terms of domestic currency. So we actually had a model for the FFX. Yeah? So something we did not need for the in arrears payment of the forward rate. So we provided a model. Note that here we provided the model for the inverse. It's N divided by N, M. So if you call the other guy the FFX tilde, yeah, which is the M divided by N, yeah, then our theorem was now formulated for the FFX tilde. So if you have a model for one of those guys, for example, for our FFX, yeah, so I do not specify the measure here, but you know the FFX is a martingale under my measure QN, then the model for the FFX just gets a minus in the diffusion part. So I just have here, note, a plus, yeah. And here I have a minus, yeah. So d1 divided by x, yeah, gets a minus in the dw part, and some other drift. But I'm not interested in the drift because I'm only interested in the covariance of this guy, the covariance of the change of numerator m divided by n with my index. Yeah? So I do not care about the dt part. Yeah, so this means that if I look at the covariance between FFX and the foreign interest rate, then actually I'm looking at the inverse, so I will get a minus gamma in my theorem. Okay, so for the quanto, we then had exactly the assumption we have in our theorem. So the covariance between foreign interest rate and forward FX rate, so by change of numerator, actually now the inverse of my change of numerator, this is Li FFX sigma L sigma FFX rho dt. So note, this implies that gamma in our theorem is minus sigma L tilde sigma FFX rho in our theorem. Okay, so minus because the theorem is with respect to the flipped version, with respect to the FFX tilde, yeah, which will then get us a minus. You could say a minus in the sigma parameter here. Yeah? I could interpret this. Actually, also better interpretation is a minus in the correlation. Okay, so I have that I can apply my theorem now with this gamma. So I have that the payment of a floater is given by adjusting the initial value, so adjusting the foreign interest rate with the convexity adjustment exponential the integral from zero to fixing time ti gamma of t dt. Note that here the notation is a bit ambiguous. Yeah, previously x tilde was my adjusted rate, but here L tilde is the unadjusted foreign interest rate. Yeah, because we denoted with the tilde the foreign interest rate. So you see that the value of the quanto floater is just paying in the unnatural unit the adjusted forward rate. And for the quanto caplet, we just get the same result as before. Replace the foreign interest rate. So replace the initial value of our stochastic process with a modified initial value, exponential integral gamma dt, but now gamma is minus sigma L sigma ffx rho. So compare this result now to our quanto, the quanto caplet, where we got exactly the same result. Yeah? So here with an e to the minus. Okay, and a last nice example, yeah, which we did not have before, is the so-called CMS adjustment. Yeah, also an important financial product, the CMS, the constant maturity swap. And we use a small other step here in the derivation because we derive some approximate convexity adjustment, a technique, yeah, that is also very often done in practice. So what is the CMS adjustment? Yeah, first let's recall a few things related to swap. So I assume we have here a time discretization, a tenor structure, and then I consider a swap. And this swap pays forward rate against some constant rate, some fixed rate in every period. So this here is the payment, and this here is now my time discretization, my tenor discretization. So I assume I have a certain time discretization here. Say this is T0 and T1, T3, T4, and so on. And what I look here is that I only look at a swap that pays on a certain sub period. Yeah. So for example, I only look at the swap that starts in TK and pays, say, for example, 3 periods here. And then it ends in TK plus M. M is equal 3 in this example. So let's consider this swap. So I have a certain time discretization and I have this swap. The swap pays the L, my index, in the natural unit PTI plus 1, so at the end of the period. If you introduce the swap rate, so from the previous picture, that would be the swap rate from k to k plus 1, you can, instead of paying the forward rate, L, fixed at each individual time, ti, I can pay the swap rate fixed at the beginning of the swap. So remember, yeah, paying, exchanging the forward rate against the swap rate is the swap that has the value 0. So I can just replace paying L by paying the swap rate. That was a trick which we also did when we derived the swaption, yeah, introducing the swap rate. And now I have a single object that is fixed at the beginning of the swap. Instead of considering paying this in every period, I could also say that I pay you the swap annuity. Yeah? The swap annuity is just paying an amount at several times. Yeah? The swap annuity was just the sum of the zero coupon bonds corresponding to the end of the periods multiplied with the period length. So you see that the period length part here also goes into the swap annuity, as well as paying at every period. Yeah. So here I only pay this once. So you remember that the value of all these guys agrees. So paying the swap rate, oops, there is a minus SI missing. Maybe I fix this. So I pay the swap rate fixed at the beginning of the period minus the constant SI. Well, then SI is just a single value, say K. Times the swap annuity. So now your K is equal to SI. So that was also a step which we did when we derived the value of the swaption. Yeah, so we were replacing the value of the swap, which is on the first slide here, repeated payment of forward rate minus constant. Here it is repeated payment of swap rate minus constant. And I can just interpret this as paying swap rate minus constant times the swap annuity, the value of the swap annuity at the beginning of the period. So that was just to recapitulate a few things from the swap. So now the constant maturity swap is a swap that pays instead of the natural thing, which is paying the forward rate at the end of the period, forward rate minus constant times period length at the end of the period. Instead of that, it pays the swap rate, well, at the end of the period. But now, okay, this looks as if it would be the natural thing, yeah, paying the swap rate. But now it pays the swap rate for a different swap, for the swap that fixes in TI, starts in TI, the swap rate fixed in TI, until the remaining periods. So if I would draw a time discretization, a tenor discretization, and assume this here is the end of my swap, yeah, so then the normal swap would pay me just the forward rate, which I observe here at the end of the period, and then the forward rate, which I observe here at the end of the period, and the forward rate, which I observe here at the end of the period, and so on. That would be the natural payment of the swap. And this guy here, okay, so instead of paying the forward rate in every period, we pay in at the end of the period, I pay the swap rate I observe for the full period. So I pay this here. Okay, so that's the payment time, this dot. And then that would be okay if I would pay this fixed swap rate actually at every point here. Yeah? But I'm not doing that. Instead, I pay you in the next period, the swap rate, which I also observe for a swap that has this length. So if this is 10 years, I always pay you the 10-year swap rate, but I always pay that rate newly observed at the beginning of the period. So you see here, this is from I to I plus M. So the length is I plus M minus I, the length is always constant. So the length of the swap rate which I observe is always constant. So I observe that rate, and here I observe that rate. Okay, so now that's it, and I pay this rate here in this period, and I pay this rate here in this period. Yeah, so a strange thing. Instead of observing the interest rate for the next period, I observe the interest rate for, say, a swap that has length 10 years, starting from now, and I pay this rate as part of a swap. Yeah, so someone could ask, I would like to exchange the interest rate, but I do not like to exchange the forward rate for the next period. I would like to exchange the 10-year swap rate on a frequent basis in this swap. And this is an unnatural way of paying. Yeah? So there are two natural things. You could pay the right thing at the right time, or I could pay here the right thing, the swap rate, in the right unit. I could pay this in units of the swap annuity. So you can take now two different views. Either we are paying the wrong index, or we are paying in the wrong unit. The financial product looks as if we pay the wrong index, but it's much nicer for our theorem to consider the case where I pay in the wrong unit. So this financial product would be okay if I would pay the swap rate in units of the swap annuity. So I would pay the swap rate also at the other times. So then the financial product would be okay. So if you have the green dots, then the financial product would be okay. It would pay you just the value of a swap in every period. Then it would be just the sum of swaps. Okay, so that was now the introduction of this financial product. So as I mentioned, the payment can be interpreted here in two ways. So either I'm replacing here the correct underlying LI by an unusual index. So I'm paying you the swap rate instead of the forward rate, or I replace here the natural unit. I pay you the swap rate in units of the annuity. I replace that by an unusual unit. I pay you the swap rate only once at a certain period. So we take the latter, the second interpretation, and can then apply our theorem for the convexity adjustment. Okay, so now there is an issue. So my change of numerator is obviously something like, let's write that down here. So my unnatural unit divided by the natural unit is maybe something like, I pay you only once the zero bond, I should pay you times the swap annuity. So now there is an issue. Yeah, do we have a model for this? So remember what we did for the quantum. We introduced a model, a stochastic differential equation that described how this object here behaves. But this object, a bond divided by the annuity, is related to interest rate. And I already have an interest rate model because I will define at least one model for the swap rate. So can I do something similar like I did for the LIBOR in arrears for the forward rate paid in advance, yeah, the forward rate fixed in arrears, that I use somehow the model I had for L as model for the change of numerator? No, we cannot do it, yeah, because this guy here is not directly related to the swap rate. Okay, recall the swap rate is the bond that pays at the beginning of the period. So here the beginning of the period would be PTI minus the bond that pays at the end of the period, PTI plus M, divided by the swap annuity. So if our change of numerator would be the difference of the two bonds, yeah, then we would be in a very similar situation, because my change of numerator would just be the swap rate. And if I write down a model for the swap rate, I immediately have a model for this guy. Okay, but we are not in this situation. And in addition, this P here is unfortunately, it is at a different maturity. So this here is at capital T, where capital T is the end of the next period. So if I just consider a single period, it's the end of the first period. So that's a bit unpleasant, yeah? So this here, I pay this in TI plus one. So actually you see that there are three bonds involved here in this thing. The bond at the beginning of my swap, the bond at the end of my swap, and I'm paying at the end of the next period. So the bond at the third point in time, the TI plus one. So I cannot derive such a nice formula without doing an additional step. And the additional step is that I will now approximate this here. I will assume an approximation for this. To ease a little bit notation, I just consider here a single period. It's enough to consider a single period. Yeah. So it's sufficient here to consider a single payment. All the other payments, it's just the sum of this. All the other payments are just of the same form. To ease a little bit the notation, S is the swap rate of this guy from TI to TI plus M. A is my swap annuity, okay, from I to I plus M. I just consider I equals one. So I have the T one is the beginning and I plus M is just N. So I have the Tn is the end, yeah? And I will then just call the payment time capital T. So I have a capital T, an S, an A, a P of capital T, and a T1 Tn, yeah? So this will a little bit make the notation a bit leaner. So I'm interested in calculating the value of paying a function of the swap rate in the unnatural unit that this is paid at a single point in time, P capital T. And I know the natural unit would be the swap annuity, so I can maybe calculate the expectation here under the swap annuity measure. Okay, so I'm interested in this using a payoff function f, an arbitrary payoff function f. So I mentioned that we need an approximation for our change of numerator. So this here is our change of numerator. This is the m of t divided by the n of t. Okay, and I approximate this. So this is here an approximation. Yeah? So I assume that this is equal to a plus b, where b may depend, of course, on this parameter capital T times the swap rate. So is this a reasonable approximation? Well, you know that if this guy here would be, for example, the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end, then this would be the swap rate. Okay, so it is maybe related, the guy, to the movement of the swap rate. So if I have a constant there, so maybe that's not such a bad assumption. Yeah, and later when you check the result of now our approximate adjustment, you see that it's quite a good approximation. So put differently, I'm linearizing here the dependency on the swap rate. So I assume the swap rate is the only stochastic driver, my only stochastic quantity, and since this here is also then an FT measurable quantity, it should be then a function of S of T, could be path dependent, but if it just is a function of S of T, then this is a linearization. The question is, what are A and B? Okay, so I have here A and B. So the coefficient A is chosen to be 1 divided by the period length. And the coefficient B in my approximation is 1 divided by the swap rate multiplied with the value of the change of numerator in 0. So bond paying in capital T observed in 0 divided by annuity observed in 0 minus A. Well, how does these two guys pop out? So the choice of A follows that I would like to have the approximation being correct in the limit case where interest rates are 0. So this means that the approximation, I assume that the approximation is of good quality when interest rates are low. So if interest rates are 0, so Li of t is 0, then the bond is 1 and the swap annuity, well, the swap annuity is the sum of the periods multiplied with the bond that pays at the end of the period, but all the bond is also 1. If interest rates are 0, then the bond is 1 and the swap annuity is just the period from the beginning to the end, yeah, Tn minus T1. So you see that in that case, if interest rates are 0, the swap rate would also be 0. And you can then solve, this goes away, you can then solve that A is 1 divided by the period length. Okay, so we have solved A. So what is the choice of B? The choice of B should be motivated from the fact that P divided by A and S are QA martingales. So I want my approximation to actually retain the fact that this is a martingale. So this means that if I take on the left-hand side QA expectation, say PT, T, AT in F0 on the left-hand side, and on the right-hand side, so A, expectation of A is A, B is just constant. So then this is S0. So, but on the left-hand side, I have PT observed in 0 divided by A observed in 0. So I would like to have my approximation correct in expectation, in QA expectation. My approximation should be correct in QA expectation. So this then implies that B of T is, say, of this form here. Okay, so now I have defined the or determined the two coefficients of my approximations. So my change of numerator should be a linear function of the swap rate, approximately, should be. The coefficients are determined by these two constraints. Well, then I can apply now my theorem. Okay, so I'm interested here in calculating the value paying a function of the swap rate at a single point in time. Okay, so the first thing is I plug in my approximation. So I have that P divided by A is now A plus B times the swap rate. So I get this, and since the expectation operator is linear, I can decompose this into these two expectations. Expectation of A times F and expectation B times F. So the first part is just paying F in its natural unit, which is nice. And the second part is paying f of s in units of s. Well, but the swap rate is just pt1 divided by pt n divided by a. So you see, this here is paying in an unnatural unit. So maybe I should make it blue. I pay the swap rate in an unnatural unit, and the unnatural unit is the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. So if this here is now my m, then the m divided by n is just the swap rate. So now let's apply our theorem. So I assume I have some valuation formula given for valuing functions of the swap rate paid in a certain unit. And I know that the second part on the previous slide, bond at the beginning divided by the annuity, this is just the swap rate. So the covariance ds, dm divided by n, this is just ds ds. And if I assume now a model, so now we assume the model ds is sigma s dw under qa. Okay, then I have, like for the LIBOR in arrears, forward rate in arrears payment, I have a sigma squared s squared dt for this term. So I have that the second part here, so this part here gets a very similar adjustment, namely a valuation formula which with a different initial value, where the adjustment of the different initial value is given here by the exponential integral sigma squared. So I have A times the natural payment and B of t times S of zero, which is the M of zero divided by N of zero, times the valuation formula using the modified initial value. Okay, so you see this looks a little bit similar to what we did for the forward rate in arrears. I have one decomposed it into one constant part that has the natural formula plus another part here. And additional step, also a technique very often done, is that here in this example, we didn't know a model for the change of numerator, but we assumed that there is a certain relation between our change of numerator and the index that appears in our payment function. So here we made this linearization. Okay, you can also define the so-called convexity adjusted swap rate. Yeah? So maybe just here on the slide. So the guy that pops out if you assume that the function is just the identity, and this convexity adjustment, yeah, you find it in a book by Hunt and Kennedy. Yeah, it's often called the Hunt-Kennedy convexity adjustment. So yeah, there is a small tool where you can play around with this adjustment, and I have here also two references where you can look this second or this last derivation here of the CMS adjustment, where you can look it up. And that was it for today. Thank you.